to speak with you this morning. I work in the venture capital and tech startup industry, which means I spend a lot of time with men and not enough time with women. So this is a real treat for me today. And one of the things, the title of the talk, Special Considerations of Women, putting that in parentheses, navigating the venture industry. I really want to direct this talk towards how anyone can be successful in the venture industry, and then add in a few comments about how women need to navigate through a couple danger zones specifically. So by doing that, I don't want to call too much attention to a lot of the negative baggage that the venture industry does have in relevance to women, but more empower you to take advantage of any opportunities that might be in the industry and to just be successful just like anyone else. So as Nova mentioned, I work with Portland 10. We're going to go through a little bit about Portland 10. I'm going to give you a bit of a disclaimer about what this talk is and what it is not. A little bit of intro to venture capital basics. Some performance standards and tips for success in venture capital, specifically in entrepreneurship. And then just some special issues for women. So Portland 10, we've had 40 companies go through the program. We had our first company hit $1 million this August, and we have two additional companies that will be hitting $1 million in the next 6 months. And so our target is to get 10 companies to that level. And that's just some information about Portland 10. And myself specifically, she already mentioned my bio, so we can move on. This is the team that we have at Portland 10. If you'll notice, we have quite a few women faces in the crowd, which is great. It's about 50-50 on staff. In fact, on staff, we have 3 women and 1 man. 1 man, and on our advisory board, it's about 50-50. So that's not something that I sought out to do. It's just kind of what naturally happened, which I think is great. And what we do is we find and develop high-performance entrepreneurs. So entrepreneurs who are sole proprietors who are going to just provide a job for themselves and maybe a couple other people through lifestyle businesses who are going to get up to about $3 to $5 million in annual revenue, or high growth entrepreneurs, which is my favorite, where they're going to scale up to 20, 50, 100 million in the next 3 or 4 years. So we have a lot of fun. And as I was getting ready for this talk, I thought, why did they ask me to speak about being a woman working in a male-dominated industry? Is it a male-dominated industry? Like, is that the case? And so I was going through our scrapbook of photos to put together some photos to illustrate some of the things we do at Portland 10, and I noticed something interesting about it. So, I'm going to give you 3 specific examples of models of relationships in the venture. $15 million, and startups then go out to customers and build a scalable market opportunity that makes so much money that they return money back to the venture firm, back to the limited partners, and then also to the entrepreneurs last of all. So that's kind of the hierarchy. So it's a food chain. The VCs have to balance right to the LPs, the entrepreneurs have to balance right to the VCs, and the customers actually are the king of it all because they're what's driving all the purchasing. So it's kind of an interesting dynamic. Internally with a VC firm, you have partners who are in the management structure of the firm, and then you have principals who have been with the firm for 3, 5, 8, 10 years, but aren't partners yet, and then you have analysts or associates who are typically in the first 2 to 5 years of their career. They're recent grads, they don't have very much operational experience, but they're scouting out deals and doing due diligence for the firm. And then you have an admin or a secretary or an operational assistant or something like that. And that's kind of the internal food chain of decision-making, because again, the VC firm is all about the money that they're deploying in a startup, so the partners have decision-making power and no one else does, basically. And so that's important to know as an entrepreneur when you're interacting. And it's also important to know if you're a woman looking to get into venture capital, because you do not want to be pigeonholed into the admin role. If you start out as an admin in a venture firm, you will never graduate up through the tracks. It just doesn't happen. So if you're interested in having a partner-level role at a venture firm, then you need to come in at an associate or an analyst level. You just have to know. And then within startups, not within the actual startup organization, but within the startup ecosystem, there's different types of entrepreneurs, right? So sole proprietor is a great business. It's necessary for the economy, but venture capitalists just aren't going to be interested in them. They're only interested in high-growth companies that are going to scale up to 20, 50, 100, 200, $400 million. So those are some of the hierarchies, and then I want to talk about some of the performance standards. So for venture fundable startups, you need to be in the top 2 to 5%. You need to be generating $500,000 to $2 million in revenue. That's before you get invested.
Yeah.
I want to be really clear about that. So you don't get venture capital to start a business, you get venture capital to accelerate your business. You need to build a strong team of 3 to 8, have a 1 to 2 year operating history, have a single client base, prior experience, and some brand level credibility. So you went to a high level MBA school, or you have brand name experience at a management consulting firm or something like that. So if you're not able to hit these metrics, then you're not going to be attractive to a venture capital firm, no matter what gender you are. So you need to know that. And the second thing is, if you want to work in investment, then these are the qualifications that you need to be working on. You need to be in the top 2 to 5% of professionals. You need to have prior experience building startup teams, be carrying a strong reputation, credibility, have a very wide network, 5 to 10 years of industry experience, preferably in a technology industry that's relevant to the type of investments that you'll be making, bring significant operational or financial experience to the table, and very key is find a mentor and start to get introduced into the ecosystem of investment. So, whether you're an entrepreneur looking to raise venture capital, or whether you're looking to be a professional in the investment industry, there's just a couple things that you can do. One is to really attach yourself to a respected mentor who already has some credibility and can open some doors for you. Second, focus on your performance. Don't think about baggage. If you have a beef with being a woman in a male-dominated industry, don't talk about it. Don't talk about it in the field. Talk about it to your therapist, your roommates, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your mom, anyone else. Don't bring that into the industry, because with it being a status and hierarchy driven industry, those who are weak or not competitive at that top percentage are just not able to accelerate up. And so it's a reality of the industry. And finally, just be a high performer and compete based, don't compete based on gender or based on issues, but compete based on your abilities, your intellect, your performance, and the accomplishments that you're bringing to the table. So that said, I want to talk about some special things that you do need to know as a woman getting into the industry. Male-female relationship dynamics. Everyone knows that dating is crazy. That dynamic doesn't leave just because you happen to be in the workplace. There's issues that men have with women, there's issues that women have with men. And if you have difficulty something that I guess I have picked up from the industry because that's how men assert their credibility. You should be listening to me today because I've done those things, according to how the industry operates. Women don't necessarily do that intuitively. We want to connect to you, so I want to relate with you, I want to have shared experience, I want to make sure that I'm careful with your emotional experience. It's not like that. So we made a mistake. We had one of our female staff that went and taught a workshop at a new organization that we hadn't really built credibility with yet, and she went in and she didn't establish credibility. She didn't talk about her achievements, she didn't talk about anything. She just dived in and talked about the content that she had for the workshop, and she got very poor reviews. And we sat down and thought about that, and we realized it was because she hadn't asserted her credibility, and so therefore the male audience didn't feel that they need to respect what she was saying because they didn't really care, because she hadn't proven her need to be there. Let's see, appearance. Men are visual. Being in a male-dominated industry, it's very visual, especially business. It's very, like, how you present yourself in what you're wearing reflects on your status of your experience in the business world, which is kind of a negative reality, but it is a reality. Attraction in the workplace, and we'll get to that in a minute. How women manage stress and emotions is very different from how men manage their stress and emotions. So that can become really messy. For example, if you're really stressed out, so you're bitchy and moody in the workplace, it's kind of a problem when you're the only one being stressed out and bitchy and moody, because it's not how the rest of the group expresses their sensibilities of anger or frustration, and it's something that you have to keep in check more so than you would if you were in a split workplace of 50-50 or even in a female room environment. And then finally, needing to have the ability to treat yourself as an equal player to be there. So if you go into a conference room and everyone's talking to the men in the room and not you, it's not going to change if you don't do anything about it. So you have to speak up, you have to voice your opinion, you have to treat yourself like you have a right to be there. Okay. A couple of dark signs, this is from my experience and things that I've had said to me or things that have happened. How old are you? Are you old enough to be doing the work that you're doing? So it's specific to being a young woman working in the field. Do you want to get drinks? Do you have a boyfriend? It comes up a lot. I started wearing a fake engagement ring just to keep people away, which is, I love it. It works for me. Why would any startup want to work with you? That was kind of a blow. I'm like, ouch, okay. Public humiliation and exclusion from social circles. Sometimes you can accidentally offend male ego just because we're oblivious to it as women. We don't function the same way. The things that hurt our feelings are very different from the things that hurt men's feelings. And I wasn't sensitive to that in the beginning. And so when you do that, then they get back at you in some unpleasant ways, sometimes and usually publicly, or ostracizing you from the group because it's hierarchical. So if you've offended someone of status, then you get the consequence of that. Being categorized into a secretarial role, I really struggled with that first year or two. Everyone kept on pigeonholing me into being a secretary, and I was like, yeah, I don't really think that's really for me. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just not what I want. And so you can't categorize me into that just because I'm in my early 20s and I'm a woman. It's not going to work for me. People automatically speaking to men at the table first. And this is what I struggle with always. I never know what to wear. If you look at all those photos, I mean, I'm always the one standing out. So I'm like, great, I'm going to stand out no matter what I wear. So I want to stand out even more by wearing something like girly and cute, or do I just try to wear something brown or black or blue or jeans? Like, I don't know, it's kind of it's probably something I'll never really totally be comfortable with. But that's the dark side, there are advantages. You always stand out, which is great. So I'm always competing in a class with myself. I don't really have any other competitors. We bring, as women, the ability to perceive, to relate, to have a different spit. We have a lot of relationship strengths, which are very critical in the venture capital industry because it's totally about having a network and being able to provide introductions and connections. We are detached from a lot of those ego and power dynamics, so we can work around those. I don't feel the need to get into a pissing match with every individual that I meet because I need to establish my credibility. I can establish my credibility based on my achievements and then just go completely around that and just focus on the task or the project or the initiative. You do get some special attention from other women in the industry or from men who want to see women do well, which is an advantage. You get the opportunity to assert yourself across genders and power structures. Quite frankly, I don't think about these dynamics a lot because it's not helpful to my success in my industry. having that ability to detach from things that other people get caught up in can actually become an advantage too. The opportunity to influence policy I'm speaking to today, not because I'm a really amazing person, but because I'm unique in the fact that I'm one out of 5,000 people working in the industry in Portland, or one out of 10 women. And I guess my overall hope is that you have a better understanding of some of those dynamics. If you're interested in venture capital, or raising venture capital or angel investment, if you're interested in working in it, that you really have a grasp of what some of these issues are, but that you feel empowered to just sidestep it, all of it, by just simply focusing on your performance and your drive and any ambition that you might.